You know, since when I was a child, and I was driving to school with my parents, we were stopping by a crossing with a small patch of grass, and I was seeing these people here cleaning the streets. They were like picking up the litter, basically. And in my mind as a child, it was something useful for society, for the environment. It was something nice that I would have loved to do. So I kept telling my mom, when I grow up, I want to be like them. And she was kind of like this, more or less, you know, whatever. Then in the TikTok era in 2022, this became fashionable. It became a sport, actually. I don't know if you've ever done, has anyone ever done plogging here? I mean, it's South Tyrol, come on. Someone has done, yeah, okay, someone, okay. It's basically a sport where you just run around, keep yourself fit, and you pick up the trash and you put it inside the bag. But you don't finish before taking a selfie, of course. Because if it's not on social media, it never happened, as Matteo Salvini says, actually. It's a 100% true quote, by the way. This guy, by the way, is the world champion of blogging. Yes, there is a world championship of blogging, so it came a long way from that moment. Then I went to university and I did environmental engineering for the same reason, because I wanted to save the world. And I studied about the many ways humankind impacts the environment. For example, the country overshoot days. Every year we consume more materials that are available for each country. And this day in the year comes earlier and earlier. So Italy is here. It's around May, so if everyone in the world lived like Italy, we would need 3 Earths to sustain our lifestyle. We also learned about global warming. This is a very, very nice graph, by the way, by the IPCC in the sixth report on climate change. And as I like to call it, it's not global warming. It is the 5 different ways we're getting screwed while trying to fight global warming. From the fastest to the slowest. But yeah, then I have another question. You know, people like study to do these things. There's hundreds of researchers. Do you think normal, like common people, they listen more like to this or to this guy here? Like, you know, this guy that is convinced that we need global warming because the weather is cold, right? This is like a living joke, basically, by now. But he's not very much wrong, because something happened in Texas, and it's very interesting, in February 2021. Let's cut the crap. An extreme winter storm, power failures, breakdowns in water system, 15 million people without power, without electricity, without gas, without water. And why did this happen? Because there is a loophole in our energy system. You can see it here. It looks complicated, but I'll break it down for you so I'm sure it's easier. So basically, the provision of gas slowed down to the plants that actually make electricity. And that in turn put the stress on companies that sell the gas. So people were without heating, basically, during a winter storm. Just remember that. Of course, no electricity and no pumping of water. So people were without the basic things we need to survive, basically, as a species. And you may think this is just something that is just, you know, the lights that went off. Yes, more or less. You know, this is a satellite image. This is like 30 million people. And, you know, people were burning furniture, like, to stay warm. So I think it is essential now to ask ourselves a question, which is, can we change our energy system to prevent this from happening again? And this is where what we do comes in. This is the energy grid of the future. It is a smart grid, because everything is smart nowadays. There is multiple things inside, but let me just focus your attention on some things, like demand response, for example. Again, I'll just break it down in an easy way. This laundry machine here is an AI-controlled one. which is able to order more detergent from Amazon when you're out of it, actually. And I just needed some device to tell me when it's done, because who has never forgotten about the laundry inside the washing machine, right? Okay, and then you have no underwear anymore, you just walk there, open it up, and it smells like something died inside, you know? So, yeah, that happens to me. Or you could have a wizard that gives you wash recommendations, basically replacing your mom. When you call her, "Mom, there's 11 programs to wash wool, which one should I use?" Like, you got a wizard. Actually, these devices are demand response, so they can change the time and the power that they use for their activity. They can do it at night, they can do it by consuming much, much less. But there is another topic that I want to talk about today, which is solar, photovoltaic. You know, now we produce electricity by using the sun. And why is this relevant? Because this is me when I looked at my last electricity bill, right? All of us probably did the same. And why is this happening? Because the costs of electricity and gas just went bonkers this year. It's just crazy. They actually went to the moon, like Elon Musk says. So you really thought there was no graph that you need to stay here and I'm going to explain this graph to you. So it's quite easy, actually. There is a problem with photovoltaic generation, which is that you produce during the central hours of the day when the sun is shining up in the sky, and you consume in the morning and in the evening where people are actually at work, actually. And we're basically producing energy that we cannot use. How do we solve this? By using batteries. And how many batteries do we need for this whole new cool picture here? We need a lot of them, actually, a lot of them. And you know, an electric system is a very complicated thing. You may have seen, of course, the high voltage cables. And these things need to be balanced, meaning that what we produce needs to be always equal to what we consume. And let me tell you, in the words of the greatest environmentalist ever, Thanos from the Avengers, perfectly balanced, as all things should be. This guy killed half of the population of the universe to avoid, you know, the end of the materials and the resources in the world. So he's the greatest environmentalist ever. And for this, we need, as I said, batteries. Oh, sorry, not these ones. These ones look cooler. Actually, these ones are the ones we use to stabilize the entire electric system and prevent all of the problems that we just showed. So, at the end of the day, this is what we do. We code the behavior of the batteries, so we make them do what is required to do to avoid problems. And we create models of electric grids. You see here, this is a balanced grid when it's green, and this is an unbalanced green when it's red or blue. And we want it to stay in green. Of course, we cannot go like blind. We need to have models that actually predict this kind of behavior. But what is the end result? Did I really achieve my objective of saving the world? Well, actually, I write these things that, yeah, are basically very overcomplicated ways of saving the climate, as per usual. But then, you know, no one reads them because everyone is going to start shouting that it's rigged and we're getting paid by companies and stuff. And, you know, I like Trump for some reason, so. So at the end of the day, I think that the people that I mentioned before, these trash cleaners are still doing a better job than me, but I hope that I'm on the right way. And I hope you enjoyed the talk. I want to leave you with a quote from the great Carl Lewis, multi-gold medal in the Olympics: power is nothing without control. Thank you.